Hello, this is Mario from ODEON. Starting from ODEON 16, Editions Auditorium and Combined support ambisonic measurements. So, in this video, we will show you how to make ambisonic measurements in ODEON with a simple setup. Ambisonics is a sound format used to capture and reproduce spatial sound. We will not explain ambisonics in detail, but if you would like to take a closer look at the theory of ambisonics, we recommend you to watch our video on what is ambisonics. But very briefly, ambisonic measurements are performed with an array of microphones, and the raw recordings are processed to produce a multi-channel B-format impulse response, where the different channels account for sound coming from different directions. First-order ambisonics have four channels, called W, X, Y, and Z. The W channel is the omnidirectional channel, while the X, Y, and Z channels account for the sound components in the X, Y, and Z directions respectively. The degree of precision, and consequently the number of required microphones, increases with higher order ambisonics. However, even first order ambisonics can be decoded into a full sphere. First order B-format impulse responses can be loaded into ODEON, which will produce spatial information such as the intensity hedgehog and the lateral energy fraction. For this purpose, the WAV file containing the impulse response should have four individual channels. Most ambisonic microphones will only output the raw microphone capsule signals, and you would need to encode them into B-format yourself outside of ODEON. However, ODEON supports the Zoom H3VR recorder, which is an ambisonic microphone that directly provides the data in B-format. It is rather inexpensive, especially considering its accuracy and robustness against noise. Simply use it as the input device in the sine sweep system, and you will get an ambisonic measurement instantaneously. There are some considerations to keep in mind. Measurements will only be reliable within a frequency range, which is determined by the ambisonics order and the spacing between the microphone capsules. Here, the upper frequency limit is particularly important, which for this microphone is 5 kHz. Another consideration is the USB cable. The microphone does not include a USB cable to connect to the PC, so you will need to supply it yourself. Specifically, you will need a Type A to micro USB cable. But also, USB cables that are low quality or too long can make it hard for the signal to get through. We personally tested with a good quality 5-meter cable, and we were still able to transfer the data. To illustrate the measurement procedure, we will perform an ambisonic measurement between two hard walls. This example is expected to produce a noticeable flutter echo in the horizontal plane. In order to use the H3VR microphone with your PC, you will need to install a driver. We will leave the link in the description. Make sure to download the multi-track driver. Although the microphone can be used on batteries, the USB interface provides power, and you will need to have it connected anyway in order to transfer the data to ODEON. Once connected, you can turn on the microphone. It will automatically display the USB menu. But you can also go there by pressing the menu button and selecting USB. Then select audio IF and 4CH ambisonics. The microphone will then output B format. You can see the four channels in the display and test to make sure that the microphone is active. Also, make sure that the order of the channels is exactly W, X, Y, Z. It should be like this by default, but if the order is W, Y, Z, X, or you get different names for the channels, you will need to go to the menu, ambisonic mode, and select FUMA. The positive X axis of the microphone will be opposite to the display. The positive Y axis will be to the left of the display. And the positive Z axis is upwards. This is important to keep in mind when orienting the microphone. We recommend placing the microphone on a tripod in a horizontal position. The display contains a tilt indicator, which you can use to make sure that the microphone is level. The source can be any appropriate omnidirectional source. In this case, we will use our very own ODEON Omni, which is close to release. For information and pre-orders, you can contact us at info@odeon.dk. Here, we have connected the ODEON Omni to the PC via Bluetooth, though you can also use a wired connection if you prefer. As you can see, the setup is extremely simple and portable. We did not even require amplifiers for the microphone or loudspeaker. Within ODEON, we open the measurement system. For the output, we will select the ODEON Omni. Now, we will go to the input device and select microphone H3VR. The type should show 4 channels Ambisonics FUMA. Then, you will be able to see the 4 B-format channels at the left side. After making sure you have an active input and setting up the sine sweep, simply start a measurement as you would normally do. When the impulse response is saved, ODEON automatically opens it. As usual, we recommend to perform a quick inspection of the impulse response on site. Particularly, one should check T30, since this parameter is the most difficult to derive from a measurement. These asterisks mean that T30 could not be derived for the 63Hz octave band, which is due to insufficient decay range. The solution here would be to repeat the measurement with a higher source gain, a longer sweep, or an optimized sweep spectrum. You can learn about optimizing sine sweeps in ODEON in our presentation for eForum Acousticum 2020. However, with this microphone, this frequency band is most likely unreliable anyway. It should be enough to have a good quality measurement between the 125 Hz and 4 kHz octave bands, and look at the results mainly in those bands. Then, the impulse response can be taken to the office PC for detailed analysis. We can load the impulse response by clicking this icon. The raw impulse response tab will actually show all 4 channels. Over here, you can look at the color coding and disable curves. Notice that the W channel is scaled by a factor of the square root of 2. This is so that the pressure corresponds to what would have been measured with a traditional omnidirectional microphone. By default, these impulse responses are rotated so that the direct sound comes from the frontal direction, that is, from positive X. In our case, we had the source approximately in the negative X direction from the microphone, at a slight angle. So, this option has rotated the XY plane close to 180 degrees, which keeps the information in the X and Y directions mostly in the same directions, but inverted. If there had been a height difference, the impulse responses would have been rotated vertically as well. If you would like to keep the microphone's original orientation, go to the context-sensitive menu here, which changes depending on the active window and tab. Then, deselect front-aligned ambisonics impulse response. If we take a look at the channel separately, we can see that the flutter echo is mostly noticeable in the white channel. This makes sense since the walls were on the y-axis of the microphone. Keep in mind that these impulse responses are for a single octave band. You can navigate through octave bands with the up and down arrows. Despite the limited frequency range of the microphone, we have found that looking at the results in broadband makes it easier to find reflections. If you wish to only use the omnidirectional channel, so as a monaural impulse response, you can change the impulse response type in the context-sensitive menu. Let's go to the decay curves. If you click on this button on the far right, you will then be able to see the intensity hedgehog. The length of the vectors represent the intensity in decibels, and the colors represent time ranges of arrival. The red vectors indicate the direct sound, and you can see that it matches the source position we showed earlier. The flutter echoes are clearly visible in the shape of the hedgehog. Additionally, because the measurement was performed outdoors, there are no echoes in the vertical direction, giving the hedgehog a horizontally flat shape. These intensity peaks are not necessarily individual reflections. We will briefly explain how they are calculated. First, the intensity is calculated for all samples in the measurement. Keep in mind that intensity is a vector quantity. Then, the signal is split in short time slices, and a vector sum of intensity is calculated for each time slice. Finally, the intensity peaks shown in the hedgehog are local maxima of these sums by time slices. This way of processing the decay curve allows you to better distinguish meaningful reflections from noise in the decay curve. Right now, the default resolution of 1 millisecond for the signal time slices allows the flutter echo to be seen clearly. You can change this time resolution with the R key. Depending on your application, you might have to adjust this resolution. If your resolution is too coarse, this will clump various reflections together into only a few peaks, and it can cancel out opposing reflections during the vector sum. If your resolution is too fine, this will add noisy components that don't have much of a physical meaning. For tracing echo events, a resolution of 10 milliseconds is typically appropriate. However, in this case, the echoes happen over a short distance, so the flutter echo is visible with a resolution of 1 millisecond and up to 5 milliseconds. In this example, it might also be interesting to find the ground reflection. I will switch to a resolution of 0.2 milliseconds. Then, it will be convenient to focus on the early part of the decay curve. You can zoom into the curves by holding left click and dragging towards the bottom right. The graph will then zoom into the drawn rectangle. The intensity hedgehog will only show the spikes currently shown in the curve graph, specifically in the intensity measured curve. You can drag the plot by holding right click. We will drag to the early part of the curve. I can zoom again if necessary. Now, the ground reflection is visible here. You can zoom out to the full view by holding left click and dragging towards the top left. This will always zoom out completely, regardless of how large you make your rectangle. Keep in mind that this tab also allows you to enable or disable the front alignment. Let's look at some other ways we can adjust the display. Again, you can navigate through the octave bands with the up and down arrows. You can navigate through individual intensity peaks. For that, you can hide the rest of the hedgehog with the H key. Then, you can navigate through peaks with the P and Shift P shortcuts, which go forward and backward in time, respectively. As previously mentioned, you can derive the lateral energy fraction from a B-format impulse response. But first, you might need to enable it for measured results. To do this, go to the Room Acoustic Parameter list. Click on Expand Tables. Find the parameter. And tick the Measured checkbox. In this occasion, you will need to close and reload the impulse response. but the changes will remain enabled for impulse responses loaded in the future. Again, front alignment is enabled by default, but the lateral energy fraction should be calculated with front alignment, so we will not disable it this time. You will find the lateral energy fraction in the Energy Parameters tab. The six main octave bands for room acoustics, from 125 Hz to 4 kHz, should be reliable with this microphone. In this example, the lateral energy fraction is quite high, due to the strong lateral reflections. You can listen to auralisations with the B-format impulse response in the Play It tab. Keep in mind that this is a feature of ODEON Auditorium and Combined. Here, the B-format impulse response will be decoded into a binaural impulse response for listening over headphones. You can select an anechoic file here. You can adjust the orientation down here, either by entering degrees or clicking on these plots. Then, you can listen to the auralisation by clicking on Play Convolution. Finally, you can insert your measured hedgehog into a room model. Here, we have a simple model of the outdoor corridor. The front, back, and ceiling were defined as fully absorbent, in order to simulate open space. This can be visualized in ODEON's OpenGL. I will press J to also visualize the source and receiver. Here, completely absorbent surfaces are rendered in black, and bright colored surfaces are highly reflective. We have also defined a single point response emulating our measurement, which will come in handy in a moment. Our receiver has been defined as pointing towards the source. This, together with the default front alignment, will orient the hedgehog nicely. Now, I will open the impulse response and display the hedgehog. Then, down here, we can select the job. You can see that the hedgehog has been aligned towards the source, and also that the intensity peaks match the expected direction of the flutter echo. If we run the single point response, we can compare the measured hedgehog versus the simulated hedgehog. You can download the measured impulse response, together with the room model, by going to our website odeon.dk, then to Downloads, Impulse Responses. With that, we conclude this tutorial, and we hope you have found it useful. Good luck!